Thank you so much for the invitation. I'm so happy to be home. Half the faces I see here are actually my family, and they're all going like, yes, go. I am not myself an academic either, and I don't work in policy. But what I can do with you all today is, and I'm going to walk around because I feel more comfortable. Does this mic work if I walk around? Okay. But what I can do with you all today here is share some of the experiences and what I've witnessed working as a journalist, traveling around the world for the past 10 years. Now, one of the first stories that I'd like to share with you is a story that I covered back in 2008. And I'll tell you this story because I think that it's intimately connected with the issue at hand today, which is human security. Darren, my husband, who's sitting right here, who's also a journalist, and we've been working together for the past 10 years, and I decided we wanted to go to Nigeria to do a story about the oil conflict there. Nigeria is one of the biggest sources of oil in the world. And in 2008, it was also, there was a huge increase in violence, where militant groups were picking up arms and they were kidnapping foreign oil workers and blowing up oil pipelines and facilities. And so Darren and I decided we really wanted to find out why this was happening. So we traveled to Nigeria and we arrived in the Niger Delta, which is the oil hub of Nigeria. And it was sort of an interesting situation because on the one hand, we really wanted to meet the militants. It's the reason we went there. But on the other hand, we didn't want to be kidnapped by them, so we had to keep a low profile. But we immediately spread word that we were there to meet the militants, and we told everybody we knew there to start inquiring whether we could meet them or not. The first thing that happens when you get to the Niger Delta is that you're immediately shocked by just the amount of poverty all around you. You know that this is a place where billions and billions of dollars are flowing from every year. And yet, you look around and all you see are slums. And we spent the first few days reporting from these slums and talking to young people, mostly young people, about the conditions in which they live. And I think we've all heard about all of this, but it was actually worse than I ever expected. You know, the no running water, no electricity. People were literally living on top of garbage, landfills, no sanitation, the whole lot. And the question that we kept asking was, why do you think this is happening? And where is the oil money going? That was our main question. And the answer we got again and again was, we don't know, but we are poor, we are hungry, we are unemployed, and we are angry. And the violence will just continue and increase if there isn't a solution for our problems here. Well, after the slums, we decided to take a trip out to Bonny Island, which is where one of the biggest facilities, oil and gas facilities in Nigeria is located. And it's just a 20-minute boat ride out to Bonny Island, but suddenly you arrive and you're in one of the richest neighborhoods in Europe. It was just incredible. You get out of the boat, and it's these large paved roads with lampposts all around, with electricity that actually works. And I was surprised. Wow, I hadn't seen a lamppost in weeks. And you arrive at the complex, and it was, I was in the Algarve, the resorts in the south of Portugal, these beautiful houses, and a golf course all around it, manicured lawns, and around all this were three fences with barbed wires, and security surveillance cameras everywhere. And right across the street, but literally across the street, was a huge slum where thousands of Nigerians live. I forgot to mention that in the compound, there are very little, if any, Nigerians living. It's all foreign oil workers. And every morning, these Nigerians who live across the street in the slum have to wake up, look across the street, and they know full well that all the money that was used to build all that security apparatus and all those beautiful manicured lawns and houses and golf courses was all built with the oil right under their feet, the oil that they, rightfully so, believe belongs to them. So on our last day in Nigeria, we got a call that the militants, one of the biggest militants, if not the biggest militant group in Nigeria, had agreed to speak to us. And we drove off, and they said they would meet us at a port in the middle of nowhere in Nigeria. We arrive, and there's no one in sight, no cars, nothing. We're a little bit nervous. And this kid, 10-year-old kid, comes and knocks on our window and says, Oyibo, Oyibo, which means white men, there's some people there waiting to see you, to speak to you. And Darren and I get out of the car, and we're walking, and Darren is tinkering with his camera, looking down, and I'm looking at my feet or something. And suddenly I look up, and there are some moments that as a journalist we call the holy shit moments. Sorry for... and this was definitely one of them. I mean, we look up, and there are seven young men, and they were carrying AK-47s in one hand and a bottle of whiskey in the other. Now, as we all know, alcohol and guns go really well together, And I think, and they were inviting us into their boat. And the instinct of everyone would be to go into their boat, which is what we did. So we went with them for a long ride throughout the swamps of Nigeria. And I'm going to need some water. Sorry. Very quick. And we arrive at base camp, and we meet the man in charge, who's a man called General Shoot at Sight. It's his nom de guerre. We're using a lot of French words today, so I thought I'd drop one too. General Shoot at Sight, that I was hoping wouldn't stand up to his name. Again, we kept on asking the same question. Where is all the oil money going? And the answer was, again, the same we'd heard in the slums. We don't know, but we are angry. And if the conditions and there, we don't start seeing some of the money staying here and there's no more development in this region, then the violence will continue. So we might all think, why do we care? You know, this is a country in the other side of the world, in Africa. Why should we all care? Well, we should actually care because it affects every single one of us sitting here today. Because every day that we go to the gas pump, or every time we go to the gas pump and we fill our cars with gas, we're paying a little bit more for the price of gas because of what is happening in Nigeria, or what was happening back in 2008, where the situation was worse. So it affects all of us. So I left Nigeria thinking, what if all the money that was used to build the security apparatus, the cameras, the fences, the helicopters, all of it, what if all that money was used instead to build schools and houses and infrastructure and would actually stay in Nigeria? Then we wouldn't need all the money to build all the security apparatus, right? It seemed pretty simple to me. And then I started reading about it, and there's this actually very popular concept nowadays that says that peace is not just the absence of war. Peace is when the majority of the population of the world has enough access to resources that they can live a dignified life. And this is the only way that we will all be free from want and free from fear, which is essentially what human security is about. So I think this begs us all the question, and it's a question that I'd love to hear the panel answer as well, which is, what if all the money that we spent arming our countries to the teeth would be spent instead in giving people this dignified life, and therefore they could live free from want and free from fear in human security? Thank you so much.